Hey Potters, welcome to episode 254 of CosPod Podcast for all things cosplay. Woo, yeah!
It Friday, yay. It'll be Saturday when everybody hears this, though.
That is true, and it's always... Well, no, I can't say it's always Friday somewhere, because technically it's not always Friday somewhere. It's always 5 o'clock somewhere.
Somewhere.
It's not always Friday somewhere. But in our world, it's always Friday, because that's when we record this show. So whenever you hear us, just imagine that it's Friday for you.
It's fine. It's fine. It's the weekend. That's all you need to worry about.
And of course, the weekend is when we work on cosplay.
Yep.
So let's get into cosplay updates. Yay!
I'm going to let this be the whole Amber show for cosplay updates, because I got nothing. Life has just been awful and hectic, so I have nothing to share. So enjoy Amber rambling for the next 5 minutes.
That's okay, because you ended up having all of the updates previously with your Bulbasaur costume. So, first things first, I did finally receive my Joanne's package. Yay! So I have my lovely molds. If you guys remember last episode, I told you about all of the steampunk and clockwork molds that they have. And it's actually the same company that does the molds that I bought. You can see this is the lovely, having nothing to do with cosplay, Italian decor mold, which this is mostly for me working with props. And likewise, there's also one with flowers, pretty flowers. This can be used for jewelry, oddly enough. So if you ever want to make, you know, flower type jewelry for Lolita type things, then these work really well. They're nice and flexible molds. They don't crack. They don't feel very dry, so I don't have to worry about them basically breaking apart in the Texas heat, which is a wonderful thing. So I got that. And then I also got Jacquard paints. These are the Lumiere Metallics, which if you have never used Jacquard paints, you are missing out. Because as much as I love Delta Ceram Coat paints, which no, they do not sponsor the show. I have used them since before I was even going to conventions, which tells you how long I've been using Delta Ceram Coat. These are actually even better.
They're better.
They're more pigmented. They work on fabric. In fact, they're intended for fabric.
Mm-hmm.
They're very metallic. Oh, they're so good. They are expensive. Each one of these is $5. And you can see how large it is in comparison to my hand. But it's well worth every penny.
Absolutely. The big thing I love about them is that you don't need many layers to get the job done.
Right. On some materials, you can actually get away with one.
Yep. Can one confirm. Layer. Especially on cottons. Oh, yeah. You can get away with one layer.
Yes. Yes. On some non-wovens, you might need two.
Ooh.
But even then, the jars of paint will last you forever if you take care of them. Keep mm-hmm. them closed when you're not using them. That sort of thing. So, I did that. The second thing I did is, of course, a pile of fabric.
It's always a pile of fabric.
It's always a pile of fabric, and I have to be very careful because there are still pins in it. Because I am actively sewing it. But this, which you can't really see much of what it is at the moment, is a corset. And this is from back when you guys have all seen my Elven Ranger costume, I'm sure, at some point in the past, either in person or on the show. And I had a whole bunch of green velveteen that looks like this. This is the green velveteen. I had a whole bunch of this left over. In fact, I had enough to make an entire another costume. And so, since that, the Elven Ranger is the long sleeve version of a costume, I decided to make a cooler version, a summer version, if you will. So I'm calling it the Elven Rogue, but it's basically the same kind of costume. The only difference is instead of basically pant length, it is short skirt length just above the knee, and it is a sleeveless corset, mm-hmm. which is what I am sewing on. And you can't see the inside of it yet because I'm, of course, sewing it inside out like you're supposed to. But there's a whole bunch of filigree work on the front, of course, because I'm Amber. This is what I do. The gems are not adhered yet, though, which I chose not to do until I have finished sewing it. Once I turn it inside out, then I will put the gems into it. But the thing that I wanted to show you guys, you'll be so proud of me. You can see casing because I put boning in my corset for the first time.
Yay! I'm very proud of Amber.
Amber.
Sort of.
It is not traditional boning. It is zip tie boning. And what I ended up doing, because of course Amber is keeping to her vow to not buy new stuff because I don't need new stuff. I need to use up stuff I have. So I took a bunch of zip ties And you've all probably seen that you can make zip tie boning on the internet. There are instructions for this. But generally, they will tell you you're supposed to use 3/8 inch boning or 3/8 inch zip ties to make the boning because you need it to be stiff, basically. Boning is meant to give structure. However, these, I will tell you, are not 3/8 of an inch.
They're definitely not.
No, they're actually 1/4 of an inch each. I measured. And so what I ended up doing is I took the little fasteners that all zip ties have, and I chopped them off, and then I laid them side by side. In fact, technically, I laid them side by side upside down, like that. And then I covered them in duct tape. Yay! So that it ended up coming out like this. You can see I have these nice, flexible, but still fairly surprisingly stiff strips. And this is actually how thick my boning turned out. It is approximately 1/2 inch. I didn't tape it very evenly on the two. I didn't center my zip tape or my zip ties, basically. So the tape on both sides is not entirely even, and that kind of drove me bonkers. But there's nothing I can do about it. But this has been inserted into the corset, so it has boning in it, and it has structure, and it looks great. And this probably cost me all of $1 to make boning. So yay, Amber's first boning! So I am very slowly, as you can see, there are still pins all up inside it. Very slowly, right now I'm hand basting it inside out, and that's because if you've ever sewn fabric that has a nap, like velvet, with a secondary fabric that does not, the secondary fabric slides everywhere.
Everywhere.
The velvet just does not want to stay in place, and it's because of the pile that velvet comes with. So anything that has a nap will generally have pile. And because of the pile, the knit fabric, which is what I had just randomly lying around, and I was like, oh, this needs a lining. So I used it. And the knit is sliding everywhere. It will not stay in place on the velvet.
Yep.
So I'm having to hand baste it to make sure it stays in place while I machine stitch it, because even the pins are not holding it in place.
That sounds about right.
Yeah. So this weekend I should have this done, and then I can insert my zipper, which I have waiting in the wings, and then it will be done. This is not entirely a standard corset. I actually added shoulder straps to it. And the reason for that is because I've never actually worn a strapless corset ever in my life. And when I tried it on, which I have a muslin of this, when I tried it on, I did not feel very secure that it would stay up. I don't know how anybody that wears strapless corsets can do that without worrying about it falling down.
I've worn a couple. I've never had them fall down before, so...
I did not feel safe, and so I added straps to it, which will basically blend in with the bolero. So it will look like a corset top. Not a corset itself, but like a corseted shirt top. And I'm okay with that. So its straps are already in here. They're already finished off. So all I have to do is insert zipper, and then it will be done. And then that entire costume will be done.
Nice.
Unless I feel like adding filigree to the skirt.
Which I'm sure you will.
I don't know. I don't want to overdo it, because the bolero is heavily filigreed. The corset, heavily filigreed. I may want the skirt to go plain just so I'm not overdoing it.
You say that.
I'll have to see how everything looks together when I'm done sewing it.
Time will tell.
Right now I'm inclined to not do it. Honestly. If I did do it on the skirt, anything I do would be very, very simplistic. Not like what's on the corset right now, and not like what's on the bolero. That was intense. So yay for using up more supplies that I have to get rid of stuff. And I will have another nice summery costume I can wear to things like Alcon if I want to.
There you go.
So... very cool there. And of course, I have still been working slowly on practicing my embroidery, now in an embroidery hoop, which I should have done the first
time. But
I didn't even really think about it until after I finished. I'm still having a lot of trouble keeping my stitches very even.
Yes, and that just takes
sometimes
time and practice.
Big, sometimes they're small. So I am less happy with this one than I was with the first one, and I don't know why. But whatever, I'm still practicing.
You're still getting there. I will say this, as the more that you do it, the first couple passes, you're like, okay, yeah, this is pretty easy. And then over time, you're just like, man, this sucks, because now you're more aware of your stitches and where they're going. Yeah. You tend to be more critical of your work.
I think that's it.
Yeah.
I think that now that I've seen it, I'm starting to be more perfectionist.
Yes.
And I'm like psyching myself out.
Yep.
Basically. So lots more practice needs to be had, I think, before I will trust myself to actually embroider something like in a costume.
Right. Just keep on doing it. Keep on making those stitches. You'll get to a point where you're comfortable enough that you're like, okay, I can move on.
Yeah. It's very stress relieving and therapeutic too.
It is.
I can generally do it with something on in the background because I don't have to sit there and stare at it like I would cross stitch.
Mm-hmm.
I still have to pay attention when I'm making my stitches, but not quite as much as I would have for other types of sewing. So it's nice and relaxing.
Yeah.
Which I like. So yay, I'm making cosplay progress.
That's awesome.
Yes, and it fits, which is a good thing considering
which is even better.
I have lost weight, which is a good thing. Well, technically I haven't lost weight. I have exchanged fat for muscle. My weight is actually the same, but my clothes fit a lot better. And I am smaller in life.
Yay.
So technically not losing weight, but changing size enough that I now have to be concerned with my costume's fit.
Fitting, yep.
Yeah, if you guys remember when I talked about pattern envelopes and how you find your size by matching the measurements in the columns, and that most of the time people are not necessarily going to match all of their measurements in one column.
Yep.
You're kind of going to have to mix and match different pieces. I'm just becoming used to that now.
Yeah, you have to zigzag.
I used to be able to choose one column, but now everything is zigzag.
I've never been able to do that, which is probably why I hate getting patterns and just making my own, because I've never been able to stick in a column. It's always like here and then here and then here. And you're just like, but all these pieces don't work together. And like,
right.
I just hate it.
Yeah, I'm basically just resigning myself to the fact that it's not simple to use simplicity anymore.
No, it really isn't.
Although, speaking of using simplicity and patterns, let me shift gears as I set my molds to the side here and I pull out our cosplay topic of the day, hopefully without dropping these. There we go. Unless you have anything else you wish to add.
I have nothing else that I wish to add, so let me go ahead and transition on over to you have the full screen. Congratulations. I will just be an ominous voice in the background asking questions and making comments.
Ominous voice.
Super ominous.
Well, as I told the audience last time, speaking of using simplicity patterns, sometimes you will go to use a pattern and there are just terms in there that are like a completely different language. You just don't understand anything that they're saying whatsoever. And I had mentioned to you all that I had picked up a sewing dictionary. And so this A to Z 1001 needlecraft terms. And of course, they say needlecraft. Sometimes cross stitch is called needlecraft,
yes.
But they actually mean literally any type of craft where you use a needle.
Nice.
So it's not cross stitch only. This is also for standard sewing. It's also for embroidery. Anything where you use a needle is what they mean by needlecraft. So this dictionary doesn't only cover cross stitch. And you can literally see the price tag on it. It is $4.98 at Half Price Books. So this little itty bitty dictionary was $5.
I'm going to go Google that right now, see where else we can find it.
It is well worth the price. The author is Marie Clayton. And it does have some pictures in it. And I'm not going to show you the entire book because copyright. But you can see that they do have some small diagrams in the book where they're basically showing you the stitch that they're talking about. One of the criticisms I have about this book is that whenever you have certain things, like if you have a certain type of stitch, like say a herringbone stitch, they'll show you a diagram, like you saw the diagram, of what the end result looks like. And they'll number the steps, and a lot of sewing books do this, and they'll put numbers on each end of the stitch to show you in what order that you're supposed to put them down, but it doesn't have a graphical display of how that looks. In other words, it doesn't show you step one, step two, step three, step four, step five. You kind of have to guess based on the diagram in here, which that it's not, like I said, it's not unique to this book. Pretty much every sewing book I've ever read shows stitches that way.
Right.
My cross stitch books do too, oddly enough.
Yeah, same thing with a lot of, even like knitting and crocheting, they do the same thing too.
Right. So you won't find step-by-step diagrams in here. You'll only see like the finished diagram, and they'll just number all of the steps on the same diagram. Mm-hmm. So it does take a little bit of reading, but they do have fairly large, you can see large paragraph descriptions. So there's a lot of text in here. They're very descriptive when they tell you how to do it. And some of these are simply definitions. Like not everything in here is a type of stitch. They'll say, oh, well, what's a Durham quilt? Mm-hmm. It'll just tell you what it is. It's not a stitch, so they don't have to tell you how to do it. It's just something that you do with, or it's a thing that you can accomplish in quilting, and quilting is needlecraft. So some things in here are just definitions, but everything in here is in alphabetical order. I don't think there are any terms that I could not find in this book that I needed to use in a pattern. So if you, you know, use even older Simplicity and McCall patterns or New Look, Butterick, all of them that have the older patterns that aren't in circulation anymore, even the terms that are in those patterns are still in this book. Sewing, thankfully, has not changed very much over several decades worth of time, which I don't say that to be joking. I say that as a good thing because it means that we still have books like this that will apply and they'll help you out. And so I can just keep this next to me along with the pattern envelope. And whenever I see something in the instructions I don't understand, I can look it up on YouTube to get a video, a visual version of what it is I'm trying to learn. And I will also look it up here. So you can always consult multiple sources, guys. You don't have to only depend on one. You don't have to only depend on this book, even though I love it to death. But it is a really good reference for me.
I have a question for you. Does it include terms that are also like tools, or is it just strictly just sewing terms?
It includes tools. And I just flipped to a random page just to make sure because I thought it did. It does include tools.
I am going to throw one at you and let's see if it's in the book.
Okay.
The word is banger, B-A-N-G-E-R. I would be very surprised if this is in here.
I have to go to B. There's a lot of C in the book.
I'm not surprised by that.
Because there's a lot of crochet in here, so I'm almost at there. Ah, nope.
We're putting this to the test.
There are so few pages at the beginning of the book, I can't flip back that way anymore. There we go. 17, 15. I think it would be... Nope.
I said, I would have been really
impressed. There's no banger in the B's.
That's okay, though. For those who are wondering, it's a wood-handled item that draws out the steam from the cloth when you're ironing it. It was worth checking, though, but I'm sure things like a gusset and all that stuff is probably listed in there.
I want to make sure. Gusset should be in
there. It should be in there. That is so common.
It's a very common. Yes, it is.
Okay, good.
Gusset is in here. Yep. G. Yes. And they also define notions in here. So things like grommets and seam rippers and things. Like if you need to know the difference between different types of tools, those are also in here. So like I said, $5, worth it. Worth it, worth it, worth it. Especially if your internet is not next to you.
Mm-hmm.
The next two books that I have in my collection, my dictionary collection, kind of go together. And I also talked about this last episode, and these two are books on how to clean your costumes, because heaven knows, whenever you go to cons, your costumes will get dirty. They will get dirty, whether you like it or not, whether you intend it to happen or not. You'll walk around places that are not necessarily the cleanest. You may end up falling on something. Somebody may spill something on you. Stuff happens at cons. And so I have these two books right here. And one of them is How to Clean Practically Anything And the other one is Stain Rescue. It's by Good Housekeeping. And they are different books. Obviously, you know, one is by Consumer Reports, one is by Good Housekeeping, but that's not what I mean. The Consumer Reports book tells you how to use different cleaning supplies. And that may not seem like it relates to cosplay whatsoever, but I actually use this whenever I need to see what I have on hand at home can clean. In other words, if I have bleach on hand, I can look up in this book bleach and it will tell me what stains bleach can clean. I can look up vinegar or baking soda and it can tell me what those things are capable of cleaning. So this will tell me if what I have on hand can clean the stain that I have in front of me, can clean the cosplay that I have in front of me, because it will tell me if it can work on certain fabrics or not. And that is a good thing, because some substances like bleach will definitely affect fabrics in a way that you may not like.
Right.
By which I mean literally taking all of the color out of them. And you may not like that. So that is why I have this book for the first. And sadly, it does not have as many diagrams in there. You can see this is pretty much all text.
Ooh, wall of text.
Yeah, this is very much wall of text. Then again, it was also $2 at Half Price Books. So apparently I did not pay enough to have diagrams in my book. The other one, this one is much more colorful. It doesn't really have diagrams per se. It's almost cookbook style. And this is the Good Housekeeping one. Now, this book is the reverse of this book. This one, you look it up by the type of stain you have, and it will tell you what it takes to clean it. So if I spilled ink on my costume, I would literally look up ink in the book, and it will tell me what I need to do to clean it. And there are some of these things that happen at conventions. So for example, chocolate stains. Chocolate ice cream desserts are pretty commonly served at conventions, especially if you have street food trucks. So that's pretty common. There's also things like fruit juice in here. That's pretty common to see at conventions too. How about soda? Also very common. You'll notice that there's a food theme with these, of course. Now, granted, there are other things like ink, like I mentioned, in here. In fact, there's even correction fluid. So if you end up spilling whiteout on your costume, this will also tell you how to remove it from your costume. So what you can do with these, not only is to keep them at home for reference, just in case, you know, something gets on your costume at a convention, you bring it home to clean it. That is one use of these books. But the other one that you may not have thought about is that you can use these to make an emergency cleaning kit. So you can get a small amount of bleach, or you can get a small amount of vinegar, and you can put it in a little spray bottle. Please make sure you label it. Label it so you know what's in it, because like I said, some fabrics and some chemicals do not react well, but label it and take it with you. And that way, if you need to spot clean at the convention, you can do that. And a lot of these can be fairly harmless chemicals. I'm not speaking of bleach, because bleach can actually be fairly toxic if you mix it with things that you shouldn't mix it with. But having things on hand like vinegar, like baking soda.
Right.
You can even get little bleaching pens from Clorox that have a very contained amount of bleach. You can get like little small fingertip spray bottles and take those things with you to the con just in case. It's always better to have them and not need them than to need them and not have them.
Right.
So you can use these books to assemble an emergency cleaning kit, which can go alongside your emergency repair kit. Hooray! And speaking of fabrics and how they react to certain chemicals, the last book in my reference collection is this little guy here. And this is the Butterick Fabric Handbook. This one is a little bit older than the others. This book has been around for quite a while. It was 25 cents at a book sale. Not at half price. This was actually a shop that was going out of business. And I happened to stop in and went, oh, hey, there's a book for 25 cents. And this looks really useful. This book is unfortunately also wall of text. However, any fabric that you would normally sew into a costume can be found in here. And what it tells you is it tells you all of the different characteristics of that fabric, what sort of chemicals you might want to avoid with that fabric, how to work with the fabric, how to wash the fabric, how to maintain the fabric. Anything that you might want to know about using that fabric is in this book. And that is why I keep it on hand, because this is how I research different fabrics for my costumes if there is a specific fabric called for. Generally, I'll go for cotton or poly type mixes in my costumes, but maybe you want to sew a historical costume that requires specific fabric. You may want to research, if you can't get your hands on that specific fabric, maybe you can find something similar in here and then purchase that instead. Mm. Or maybe if you see a fabric, you're browsing Amazon or Spoonflower or something, and you want to know more about the type of fabric you see on the screen because you haven't ever worked with it before. And that happens to me a lot on Spoonflower, actually, because they have just so many selections now. They are not a sponsor of the show, but they have so many different options that I don't even know what to get.
Mm-hmm.
Just because there are so many options. And it's like, well, okay, I can choose based on appearance, like how the fabric looks in the light. Is it shiny? Is it matte? That's pretty much all I can really tell, though, from just looking at a screenshot on the internet. I can't tell what kind of hand it has. How does it drape? How do you maintain it? Is it easily washed? Which for cosplayers is a really important thing, might I add. Does it wrinkle easily? You know, am I going to be able to iron this if it happens to get wrinkly? Because when you wear costumes at a con, even if you ironed the living daylights out of it before you put it on, I promise you by the end of the day, it's going to be wrinkly.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Because that's just how fabrics are when you wear them on the human body.
Mm-hmm.
They'll lose that nice crisp feel. So I need to know, can I iron this? At what temperature can I iron this? If I iron silk at the same temperature I iron cotton, I'm literally going to burn a hole through the silk because it cannot take that kind of ironing temperature. Would not have known that unless I looked it up in this lovely book. Or on the internet, of course. But I like to have physical books next to me instead of looking everything up on my phone.
Well, and then sometimes the book can be a little bit better, because if you're just kind of struggling to think of, okay, what's the name of the thing that I'm looking for? If you don't know the exact term of the fabric or what you're trying to think of, Google can only get you so far. Sometimes just flipping through a book until you land on the page, you'll get you faster results.
And you can use these in tandem with Google. Like I said, none of these have to be used by themselves. You can use this alongside the internet. Just, I find these, especially since they've been written by the people who work with fabrics on a normal basis, to be somewhat more credible than some of the things I may have read on the internet. I mean, likewise, Consumer Reports, it's their job to investigate products and whether or not they clean stains well. Same thing with Good Housekeeping. Literally, their job is to review products that clean stains and tell you which ones work and which ones don't. The only one that actually isn't necessarily written by, you know, a known expert would be the dictionary. And that's only because I don't necessarily know if Marie Clayton has been working with sewing products for her life. But I can certainly find that out. So these are my four lovely books in my cosplay reference collection that I keep with me, just in case I happen to, you know, stain my cosplays, if I need to buy fabric for a new costume and figure out what the heck I'm working with, how to clean it, how to maintain it, all of those good things. Because, you know, you want your cosplays to last you a long time, given the amount of work that you're putting into it. These are not, no offense to Party City, these are not Party City costumes that are only meant for maybe a wearing or two. You want these to last you for years if you can help it. So that is what I have for you today.
Very nice, Amber.
Thank you, thank you.
Good job. I'm actually looking up Miss Marie Clayton right now, and she looks like she has several books. Let's see. So she's an experienced dressmaker and tailor who lives in London. She's got an ultimate quilting Bible, how to use a sewing machine for beginners, a craft Bible. Let's see. There's quite a few books in here. There's some that are just patterns and nothing but patterns.
Right.
So it seems like she just has a lot of experience and history of experience. So she probably knows her stuff. So there you go.
I actually do have quite a few more books in my sewing reference type collection, but they're not quite as referencey as a dictionary. They're more of the complete book of sewing, photos of all techniques. And that's, it's a little more extensive to review, and it's also a lot more specific because I don't need the entire book. Generally, I'll only have to look up like one technique, and then that's all I need out of the book. Whereas this, I tend to need much more of when I look up multiple terms. So the other books I can always review at a different time, but one of these days I will just post on our site a listing of all of the different cosplay related books that we have access to, in addition to the Humble Bundle, which last I checked is still available as of this recording. So if you haven't gotten it by this point,
I don't think it is anymore.
It isn't?
I don't think so.
Now I have to go look.
I'm Googling right now. Hang on.
I have to go look. We're doing it live, kids.
Oh, it means somebody's post was incorrect. So it ends in 5 days from now. So it's moot to anybody who's listening to it now because it's gone.
Indeed. Occasionally, if a bundle is very popular, then they'll sometimes extend it. And so then you can pick up a copy later on. But generally those end up being so popular that you kind of have to jump on them while you can. I'm very happy that we ended up getting a copy. I know some of the books are repeats, but one, I like supporting cosplayers. And two, there's always something useful in the bundles. Every single one has had something useful in it that I can get something out of. Granted, they are ebooks. They are not like physical books. But sadly, you cannot find those physical books at half price. They're only available as ebooks. So I'm telling you guys, there's nothing wrong with a good book, whether it's physical or not. Books are still around and sometimes still better than the internet. And I do actually, speaking of that, Amaris, I actually do have a couple of pattern books. There's one for costumes and there's one for accessories. There's not very many of those anymore, though.
Nope.
Very, very few books of patterns. And even then, the patterns that they put in the books, just like standard patterns that you would have on, say, a PDF, you end up having to blow them up to expand them.
Right.
So that they're the right size. Because you can only fit so much of a pattern onto an 8.5 by 11 page. And so either you have a bunch of pages you have to tape together, which is not always fun, or you have to go to your local friendly print shop and ask them to expand it several times. Either one works, though, and it's still much better than tissue paper. Sorry, McCall's in simplicity.
Tissue paper gets ruined
like
so easily.
I don't like patterns coming on tissue paper. I will die on this hill. I insist on a minimum of craft paper. And my jacquard paints just knocked my embroidery onto the floor.
Whoops!
So excuse me for a moment while I pick this up off the floor, because stepping on that needle would be really unpleasant without socks or shoes on.
Well, Amber is getting ready to do that. I've got nothing else to add unless there's anything else that you would like to add.
No, that is all I have for this episode. I was wonderfully productive and busy, and I hope to continue that as we roast under the Texas sun.
Yay!
Honestly, I my heart goes out to those who are attending Project Akon. I'm actually really happy I'm not roasting outside, because I have attended Akon when it was 92 degrees outside in full cosplay.
It's awful.
That was a fully lined kimono cosplay that had layers. And it was 92 degrees and it rained outside. So it was also 100% humidity.
No thanks.
Not the most fun con I've been to.
I'm going to pass on that.
So I'm going to stay indoors where it's nice and air conditioned and there are fans, and I can sit here and sew on my cosplay instead.
There you go. Good alternative.
And think of perhaps Maybe some new names that Nick Cage can give his new child.
There you go.
And with that, we will, of course, invite you all to join in the conversation. If you've got some really good reference books that you use when you're making your cosplay, feel free to let us know via any of our social media, which, of course, you can find here.
Everything is located underneath Amber. If you are listening to us, be sure to visit us on cospod.org, on Facebook and Instagram at Cosplay Podcast, or on YouTube and Twitter at CosPodcasts.
And, of course, you can email us, podcast@cospod.org, where you'll get an answer from both of us and probably at least one Nick Cage meme. Maybe more. Otherwise, we will wish you guys happy cosplaying. Please stay safe and stay healthy out there. Keep working on those cosplays so that we can all meet up again in costume at your favorite local convention ASAP. We'll see you guys next time on the next episode of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Happy cosplaying, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.